Yeah? Okay, hello everyone. Welcome to this presentation about Linux command line magic. I'm Peter Martin, I'm from the Netherlands, and that's about 150 hours of walk from here. I don't really like Windows. If you have Windows on your computer, I don't mind. But I switched in 2007 from Windows XP to Ubuntu Linux, and currently I'm using Debian Linux. I was told that Windows 7 is much better, so I won't criticize it, but I just prefer Linux at the moment. And this is my favorite machine. And this is a Raspberry Pi. I learned a lot of command line magic using the Raspberry Pi, because I was using Linux just with the GUI. So it looks like Windows or Apple. And sometimes I switched to the command line to do stuff. But with this machine, I didn't connect it to a television set. I forced myself to do stuff on the command line. You will probably have something like this. Not at home, of course, but somewhere in a hosting center. If you have a good hosting company, they might give you access to this server using SSH. And this is what this presentation is about. I will first tell you something about Linux in general. I will show you some basic commands, the basics of Linux, how you connect to the to another machine, using scripts, creating backups, finding files, how to recover from a hack. The previous presentation, I mean the keynote, was about websites that got hacked. I have some solutions to rehack, unhack. And I will end with how to set up your own testing environment using Vagrant and Scope in a Box. So, first of all, who is using Linux? Okay. Who uses Linux on the command line? Okay. So, I hope that you will have more about the final part of this presentation and the other people. I will start with them. First of all, Linux is an operating system for all kinds of devices and all kinds of different CPUs. You have probably an Intel processor or maybe AMD, but if you have a Raspberry Pi, it's an ARM processor. And it's also available at other devices, like who has a TomTom car navigation? No one. Garmin? I don't know about Garmin, but TomTom has Linux inside. You don't see it, you only see a sort of layer above it. Linux is open source and also free. It's really stable because it was derived from Unix, and Unix was made for mainframe computers where multiple people had to do work on the same computer doing different programs at the same time. It's also very popular because it's free and it's really stable. And therefore, a lot of hosting companies use it. Oh, and of course, I said it was Unix-like. It was made by Linus Torvald, a Swedish person studying in Finland. And he wanted to have Minix on his 386 computer. And Minix was a sort of Unix operating system for MS-DOS kind of computers. He wasn't able to run it over there. So he thought, okay, let's make something which looks like Minix, and he started it. It was not a huge project, but it became open source, and people started to help, and yeah, result is we have a lot of different users, a lot of different distributions, because if you want to use Linux on a machine, you can use it on a desktop or maybe a server, you have to choose for a distribution. There are roughly two kinds of distributions, the Debian kind. If you want to install binary packages like software, you have to use the DEB, D-E-B. And of course, Red Hat and all the kinds of Red Hat package manager. If you want to install such, then you need Red Hat, like Fedora, CentOS. It doesn't matter which version you use, just it's personal preference, I think. I started with Ubuntu. And now I'm using Debian. Linux Mint, by the way, is also Debian. You have also some other systems like Slackware, Arch Linux, and Gentoo. And they are for the more experienced users. Is anyone here using Gentoo or Arch Linux? Okay. With Arch Linux, they have a really nice philosophy. You install just a really minimal package, and then you have to do everything yourself. It's not for you for beginners. But if you have a lot of knowledge, then you can really tailor-make everything. And if you want to be, if you are really a hardcore a Linux command line fetishist, then maybe you want to use Gentoo, because with Gentoo you do the same as with Arch Linux, but you run scripts and it will compile everything you need, especially for your machine. It takes a lot of time. If you are using SSH to your hosting company, it could also be some other computer, a system like Unix. And there you have two variants, like the commercial ones and Mac OS. People with a Mac, you are using Unix, without knowing maybe. And also the free ones. So what commands would you need to start with Linux? The first command, the most useful, is man. This is a manual of a command. So if you want to have the command manual, I mean, if you want to know something about manual, you do man, and then you have the manual about the manual command. Has anyone here used MS-DOS in the past? Yes. Okay. You know dir. Okay. On Linux systems, it's ls, list. And with this option, you will get a list of all the files, including the hidden ones. The list version is really useful because you can also use a list for other stuff, like a list USB, and you will see all the USB devices connected to your machine, or LSPCI or LSMod. By the way, I will make this sheets available after the presentation. So if you like to photograph it, it's okay, but you can also have them on the sheet. So to create a new directory, you do mk, make, and remove a directory, rm, remove. So, but if you create a directory and you want to go to the directory, anyone? Yes. Change directory. And with change directory, you can use different options, like change directory to the folder which is in your current folder, or two dots, then you go back one folder. The tilde, is your home folder. Like if you are using MS Windows, you will have My Documents. Well, this is the My Documents of Linux. And of course, you also can specify it directly. With cat, it's concatenate. You can list the contents of a file, like cat configuration, and you see the configuration file of your Joomla. And if you want to change something in that configuration file, you can use nano. If you are real hardcore, you probably use Vim or VI. Don't tell anyone, and please don't say it to anyone on the internet. I use nano. it's easier. Copying stuff, cp, and then you can copy this file just to a new file. Instead of copying, sometimes you have to move stuff or maybe rename, and then it's mv, move. And I already showed you how to remove a directory, but you can also remove a directory with all the contents. It's rm. This is really dangerous. Using rm with an uppercase R means recursive, so I will remove everything below it. I mean, in the folders and all the subfolders. So if you install Joomla and you have to remove the installation folder, you can do it like this, and everything in it will be removed. If you are using a web server with files, you probably run into permission problems, or if you have a good hosting company, you won't. But if you do, and if you have access yourself, you can try something like change permissions. The sudo I will tell in a minute, but change mod is to change the permissions. Or ownership is another problem. It's change ownership, and then you can change the ownership of a file or folder. But I will tell you something about ownership and permissions in a minute. So the basics of Linux. Actually, the name Linux is not really the good name, the proper name. They could have named it in a better way, like files are us. Everything in Linux is a file. Even all the processes in memory are files. I mean, they are considered as files, so you can access them as files. So you can do a cat with a certain folder, and then you get the contents of a process in running in the memory. So everything is a file. And with files, you have permissions and ownerships. So there are three kinds of permissions: read, write, and execute. And if you want to have read and write, then you just add the 4 and the 2. And so 6 is read and write, and 7 is read, write, execute. So who knows 777? Yeah. Then everyone, the owner, the group, and the public have read, write, execute. Sorry? Yes, yes. So if you look at ownership, an owner can be a username, like my own username if I'm on the computer, but it can also be a process running in the background, like Apache web server, which is probably user www.data. And you can also have certain groups, and you can add maybe the Apache and my own in the same group, and then you can do other things with it, like if the group has read, write, execute, then the group can do everything with it. So in short, if you are on the command line, you do something like ls, you will see something like this, which means read and write. The first couple of bits is the owner, then you get the group, and then public. So this is 644. This is how it should be with files. And folder should be 777.
755.
Oh, sorry. Oh, yes. 755. Oops. Yes, but therefore I will tell you something about how to unhack your website. So you have different kind of users. You have the root user, which is me. And you have the just regular users. If you are logged into a Linux machine or somewhere on the server, you will see the cursor at the end. It might be a dollar sign or a hashtag. If it's the hashtag, then you are a user, the root, and otherwise you're just a normal user. And you can see it with the command "Who am I?" and it will show if you are which username you are. You can change to another user if you know the password of the other user. Like maybe some user has a problem, so I can do su, which means change of a switch user, and then the other username, and then I think I have to know their password, or otherwise I should do it as root user. So some people can if a file is executable, then you can just run it if it's executable for public, groups, and owner. But if it's not, sometimes you have to run scripts that need real high permissions, and then you can use you can set the execute permissions to it, or you can use sudo. And if people have children, in Holland we have this when the children have red buttocks. So with sudo, you switch to the super user and do the commands. So you have the tilde, which means the default folder. You can do things with files, and with greater than, you will just output the thing on the screen to a file or to some other device. And with two of those, you will add it to the other device. One of the nice things with Linux is everything has just one purpose. You have different programs, and you can chain those programs. You use the pipe. So, for instance, I have my file. It's a configuration.php, and I want to see the password of MySQL. You can do cat, which means print, configuration.php, and then it will print everything. And if you do like tilde, and pipe grep, and behind grep I put the command less. Grep password, and it will only show the line with the password in it. When you work with files, you can also make sort of symbolic links to files or folders, which can be useful. So you use the command ln link, with S, which means symbolic, and then you can just create symbolic links. It's useful, especially when you want to do something with GitHub and create something in a folder, but the folder needs to be in your Joomla website, and then I just create symbolic links. So to connect to another computer using SSH. In the past, they had mainframe computers, and when you had to connect to the mainframe computer, maybe to print something, you used the terminal. And TTY means teletypewriter, meaning I do something here, and at the other side, another building, there's a really large printer printing everything I type. So that's the history behind the TTY, or the terminal. If you have Windows, you can use a terminal on your own system, but you have to install something called PuTTY. And in Mac and Linux, it's already built-in. So SSH, I already mentioned it a couple of times. It's the secure shell. And secure shell means you just make a connection, and it looks like you're working on your own computer, but you are working remote. If I want to connect to my Raspberry Pi, which is in my own network, I do, and my username is Peter, I do SSH, the username of the person I want to log in, and then the name of the computer. So what if you do it on the internet? It will look something like this. And if it's everything is all right, you will get something like this. And if you have a good hosting provider, they will have a page where they share their fingerprints, so you know that the computer you're talking to is really the computer you want to talk to. You have to compare those. I think this is, if you do a lot of work with two computers, you can also create a public key, public-private key pair. This is too technical here, I think, but this is what you have to do. The public is you put on the other server, and the private you keep on your own server. So when you make a connection, you don't have to log in anymore. So one of the things with Linux is you can use scripts to automate stuff, and especially repetitive tasks. It's really, really good to create scripts like do backups on regular times. Then you have to create contacts. And if you create scripts, it will probably be a shell script. There are two shell scripts. This is the original one called a born shell. If you look at the file, which is a script, it has to start with this. bin sh, and sometimes bin sh doesn't exist on your computer, but it's a symbolic link to bash, and bash is just some better. It's a born again shell. That was a joke. If you are using Debian, you might see something like dash. This is only for Debian and Ubuntu, and it's used during startup, but not anymore. So what if you want to create a script? You have to just create a text file. In the text file, you will start with something like this. Then if you run it, Linux sees, oh, this is a script. And you have to declare something like string is hello Joomla, and here I print it. Actually, it looks a bit like PHP. So backups. Who makes backups? who doesn't? Of course, you can use Akiba Backup, which is a nice solution. Sometimes you want to make backups, but you don't have access to the website. But you have access to SSH, and then you can use backups using rsync. With rsync, only the things that have been changed will be put on the other side. So transferred, I mean. This is the command you have to use. I don't go into that, but it's really, really fast. It's faster than FTP. So if you have a lot of files and you need to FTP, you can also use this to FTP instead of FTP. With Akiba, you also have the database in it. Here, it's just the files. So to have the database in it, you use MySQL dump. And here, you have to add your username and then the password you have to type in. You will create a file of the database. Sometimes customers will phone you they lost the information on the site, on the server, and you have to find the file. For instance, an image, and they know the name, but they can't find it anymore. If you log in, you can use the word find. Locate is faster, but for locate, you have to update a sort of database because it stores all the files in the database, the names of them. You can also use where is or which to locate scripts or manuals or path names of files. So for instance, I'm looking for my configuration.php. Of course, we all know it's in the root of your website, but assume we don't know that. You do something like find. Here, I want to start my search, and my file is named configuration.php. This is the method to use it. When you have clients and they have websites, they put stuff on it you don't want to know. Really huge files, maybe 10 megabyte files. And they are complaining about, I have too little room on my hard drive. So you want to find the biggest files on the server. This is what you can do. With this command, you get a list of the 15, because it says 15 here, the 15 largest files in your server. And here with the dots, it starts where you are and where you're typing the command. So maybe you could also use var www to do it in the website. Or maybe something happened on your site and you want to see which files have been changed in the last 7 days. This is the way to do it. You are looking for files and the change time has to be 7 days ago. Or maybe something happened between the last 7 and 3 days. You do the same, but this is not create but modified, therefore the M. And it says -7 means it should be 7 days, but not, this is not 3 days. You all have clients or websites with a lot of images. Do you clean up the images? No, nobody does. Me neither, but sometimes you have to. So how would you find unused files, unused images? It's difficult. You have to look in all the articles. If you have a lot of articles and a lot of files, it's the no-goer. So here at JM Beyond, René Greifeld, some know him, he is also here present. He wrote a really nice script. It's called JFindFiles. And with this script, you start a script and it will create an SQL dump of your database. And then it will compare the SQL dump with all the images that are in the images folder. If you have files that are stored in your template, it won't find it. But these are just a minor. This is really, really, really convenient to do it for the images that are used in articles. Who has had this problem? It's not fun. It can happen. It can happen a lot if you're not secure. And what you have to do is make a backup. And if you can create a backup of the current situation, then you can experiment with it. And you can look for things. And maybe you can, if you mess it up even more, you have a backup of the hacked website. And, well, you can do stuff with it. You have to analyze the hacked files, the log files on the server. And you have to find the vulnerability. There are some things which you could do. Like if a hacker hacked your website 10 days ago, you can find all the files, look for the files that have been placed on the server 10 days ago. It's a good method, is it? If you have stupid hackers, yes, it's a good method. Last year, I had a hacker. I mean, there were two hackers on the customer's website active. One of the hackers was a clever hacker. They hacked the website. They put a file on the website with a backdoor script. And the date was of 2 years ago or something like that. But it was placed on the server a month ago because I had two backups. In one backup, it was not there. And on the other, it was. But the date was still 2 years before that. The stupid hacker put all kinds of scripts in the website with just the current date. You can find all those scripts, but take care, it can be modified. So this is what you can do, the new files or the in the last 10 days. And you can look into the files if it contains hacker script. And have you ever seen hacker script? It has probably base64 and decode. Sorry?
Eval,
yes, of course, yes. Yes. So what you can also do is you can look for eval or a base64 decode. Yes?
There's actually some of that in GNOME core. Legitimately.
Okay.
So be ready.
Oh, sorry. You mean there is EVO and base64 in Joomla? Yes. And there is also an Akiba backup and other.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
So prepping for that may not be the most effective.
I would recommend grabbing this and take care. Don't just delete those files. Because you're right, it gives false positives as well. However, base64 decode can be concealed. The clever hacker of last year, he didn't have a base64 decode. He used slash a value, slash a number, slash number, and he used something like prec replace to replace the numbers into the real command. So he hid it. And so this is also not you can use it as first attempt, but I think this one is somewhat better. There's an open source script in Python. It's called NeoPy, and when you install it, you can use git clone to clone it from GitHub. When you install it, it will give you lists of files that contain vulnerabilities or that are suspicious, because it will also show some Joomla files. It will also show Akiba backup, because they have are really large, and it also shows the really strange files. So it gives a lot of false positives, but it gives you a pointer. What you also can do, I had this client. I made a backup of their website a year ago. And then they phoned me. I also advised them, please make backups. They didn't. And a year later, they phoned me, Peter, yes, I know that you advised us to create backups, and we want to do it now, but we got hacked. You're too late now. So I solved it by just making another backup, because I advised you to create a backup of the hacked website. And in this case, I installed the backup and the backup of a year ago, both on my system. And then I did a diff. And with diff, you can see the difference between files, but also folders. So I was able to find all the new files. And it was really easy to get rid of the hacked files that way. Sometimes you are using a computer, and you want to install other software. Like, I need to install Windows. I mean, I need to install Internet Explorer to check websites, but I don't have a computer with Windows on it. So I use VirtualBox. Who uses VirtualBox? Virtual Machine? Other virtual stuff? Because there's more. Okay. It's really neat to use virtual stuff, virtual boxes. You have a sort of box within your computer, and you can install an operating system in it. And then you can connect to it and run it. I will show it later on. It has a GUI, so you can do anything in the GUI. But it's nice to use the command line for it. If you want to install something like Debian, you need a disk of Debian or an ISO image. To install Debian will take maybe 30 minutes or so, and to install Windows maybe an hour. So it takes a lot of time. And when you want to speed up this kind of stuff, you can use Vagrant. Vagrant is really nice. Vagrant is a sort of wrapper around your virtualization software. It can be Virtual Machine or VirtualBox. And with Vagrant, you can install an operating system from the cloud. And it will take 5 minutes instead of half an hour. To do it, first you have to install Vagrant on your local machine. And you can find it on vagrantup.com. And for Debian, you have to install the Debian version, DEB. And to install it on your local machine, you have to use this command, which means Debian package. And this is eve of installation. It's a bit like a Git. With Git, you have a file called a .git or a folder .git, and it stores all the information about a repository you just cloned. With Vagrant, you have a file called Vagrant file, and Vagrant file will store every information about the box you cloned and also all the configuration you made. So you can go to Vagrant Cloud to get virtual environments, and you can just search for it. You can even find Joomla in it, because Johan Janssens, yes, a company Joomla Tools, they created a virtual box with Joomla in it to test stuff. You have to install it using Vagrant Box Add, but if you don't do it like that and just do Vagrant init, it will do it as well. You have to change the Vagrant file. Sometimes you have to make sure that the port forward is open. I will show it in a minute. To start Vagrant, I mean your Vagrant box, you just do Vagrant up. And to log into your Vagrant box, you just do Vagrant SSH. You don't have to log in anyway. And I think this is just how to use stuff like to install a web server. I included it. I won't dig into it. If you have the sheets, you just can copy paste it in your VirtualBox to create your own environment. You can also just download an environment where Apache web server is already installed. But you have to be careful, because you don't know what's in there. If a hacker creates a nice VirtualBox for you, well, you have hacker scripts on your system, you don't know. Most of the things are available in Vagrant Cloud are from, how do you say, trustable sources. You have to look at the source. If it's like a Chef, or I think it's Chef. It's one of the trusted sources. You will see, you can also see the downloads, and if it's downloaded a lot, and if it has hacker files on it, people would have noticed it probably already. But that's not really something you have to trust on 100%. So, installing Apache web server, and if you have run into issues with ownership of files, you might want to change this file and say, okay, the user, or I mean the owner of the processes and the group is both Vagrant, because you're running everything in the Vagrant box and Vagrant is owner of everything in it. Install PHP, MySQL, and PHP, MySQL, the connector between those. Install PHP, MyAdmin. You can also use command line, but I prefer this one. And with localhost 8080, PHP, MyAdmin, you can create a new database. And then installing Joomla, wget, you can get a file. This is also nice if you want to clone a website. If you have a customer and they want to have a backup of the website, or you have some other place you want to store, you can use wget. You can even use wget with some parameters to store only the zip files on the site. It's nice. And the last thing. If you are into Linux, into Vagrant, Docker is really interesting. When you want to install, want to use Vagrant, you have a box with a operating system in it, and then everything I just showed you, like PHP, Apache, MySQL, and your Joomla website. It's a lot of information, a lot of files in it, a lot of software in it. But if you want to use Joomla with PHP 5.5 or 5.6, you have to do it again. Or you have to find a way to replace one PHP version for another. What you also can do is you can use Docker. Docker is really nice. It's instead of one box, you have multiple boxes. And you have to connect those boxes. So one box, your operating system will be the operating system for all boxes. And in every box, you just run a program. Like in one, you will run PHP, another MySQL database, another the file system for your images. And you connect those. So when you have PHP 5.3 running, you just bring the box down, bring a box PHP 5.5 up, and you can test it with PHP 5.5. There is one disadvantage of this. When you bring down a box, like the database, all information in it will be destroyed. So if you want to kill a process, you first have to make a backup of it. And you can also have the boxes running on multiple machines. So I can have a server here. I can put a box on another machine. I can connect it. And when I need more capacity, I put boxes in other places.
I think you can store database to your
request. Oh, yes, that's a good point. Yes, you can store the database to your real file server on your system, and then you can then it backs up automatically. I mean, if you bring it down, it's still on your system. I would like to show, are there any questions? Otherwise, I would like to show you some Vagrant. No? Vagrant? First of all, I have to get the other screen away. Sorry. So this is the command line. My name is username is PE7ER. My system here, I have a T410 ThinkPad. So this is why you will see it over there. And now I'm just a normal user, so you will see the dollar sign. So when I was doing a presentation about 10 years of Joomla for Joomla Days Holland, I needed to install all the different Joomla versions, but I didn't want to install it on my local machine. If I go on my local machine, let's kill this and start again. Okay. So if I do localhost, I have my own web server installed on this machine, but I didn't want to mess up with that. So what I did, I installed Vagrant, and what you can see is it says Vagrant file, and if I do ls all, you can see it also have a hidden file, a hidden folder called .vagrant, but the Vagrant file is the file you need. And if you are typing on the command line, and now I have only one file with a V, I can do tap, and it will autocomplete. So this is the configuration file of Vagrant. I create my own box with Debian. I called it Joomlas. And in this box I created here, it says configuration network forward port guest host 8080. So when I do 8080, nothing is there. But when I'm in this folder, in the Vagrant folder, here I have my Vagrant file. I just do Vagrant up, and it will bring back, start up my VirtualBox. Now it's ready. This is these are my websites, my Joomla websites, Joomla 1, or even Joomla 100. This didn't have a Joomla logo. The Joomla logo was, there was a contest back then, and I think 2 or 3 days after this release, the logo was chosen. So in 100, there is no logo, and in 100, I think this 102, the Joomla logo is there. So this is how you can just create new things, new virtual machines on your server. And if you, I go to the virtual box, I never use it like this. I should have virtual system. Oh, Oracle virtual box. Okay. So you can see here, this one is running. And if I switch it off, like, oh wait, I will go into the box. So with frequent SSH, I'm in the box now. And I can see all the files on it. And here are all my Joomla websites in this folder. And with exit, I go back and vagrant. I can do vagrant hold or vagrant suspend. In this case, I suspend it. So it's off again. So if I want to create a new box, I already have the my own Joomla's box here, but I can do something like make directory JM beyond 15 and go into the box. Now there's nothing. So if I go to Vagrant Cloud, I can look for a distribution. Oh, it's really slow. Like Debian Minimal. And here I see Debian Minimal like this. And if I look at it, it says, okay, you can do vagrant init minimal like this. So I copy this, and in my JM Beyond folder, which is now empty, it's empty. I can do vagrant init minimal VC, and it will create a virtual box from the cloud. First, it created a vagrant file. It says vagrant file, and this is how I can just see the first part. It's a minimal VC. It says it here. And I have to do something here with the port, the host. But first, let's install it. And this will take too long, so I will cut it off. Because here it says it will take 1.5 hours. If the internet connection is slow, it's the first time you install it. But if it's installed on a computer already, that's what I'm going to do now. So this is really dangerous, especially this. Don't try this at home. So, okay, I already have the Joomla's. So if I do vagrant up Joomla's, vagrant. In it. Okay. And I go nano. Here it says the name of my box, which I can clone over and over again. So you can maybe have a vagrant file, a vagrant environment for every customer. I don't know if it's useful, but and in this case, I might want to access it like instead of 8080, 81, so I can have multiple running at the same time. Then I save it, I exit it, and with vagrant up, it's already in the Joomla's folder, and it knows it's Joomla's. It says it in the configuration file. It will create a new instance with the box I already have on my machine. It's faster than just starting it, and it's not on already, so therefore it's not here. Yes, sure.
Is vagrant not something like Timber player files?
I have no idea. I don't know.
It's a lighter version of it.
Okay, but vagrant you can use with virtual machine as well. Is a player file some sort of instructions?
I go to the Vimmer site and say, okay, I want this, this. Like an access.
It's a true VM, meaning the entire OS is basically injection in a ginormous start.
Okay. Something I didn't tell you. I showed you, I have some things I run to create a web server of it. You can automate it using Chef, Ansible, or whatever. These are sort of installation scripts. And it's really difficult. But if you have to do it more than once, do it like that. So now I have my own my new site. And with Vagrant up. Oh, I already had it up. Vagrant. Oh, and I will show the VirtualBox. It has a new instance here now. This one is saved, and I can also start the other one if I want to. This is just. And I something else. I'm really used to the command ls. If you do stuff, you need to know the files. And one time, there was a vulnerability. It was called Shellshock. I don't know if you heard about it. I was at a hosting provider. I was doing command line stuff, and I made a mistake. Instead of ls, I did ls. And this happened. Apparently, someone thought, well, let's educate people in typing right, because sometimes people do like ls, and sometimes they do sl, and sl, okay, sl, steam locomotive. So therefore, but I was, oh no, I got shell shocked. I didn't know exactly what it was, and then it was just this. So, okay, this is a bit of Linux command line magic. I hope that I. It motivated you. I showed you a couple of things you can do yourself. Yeah, I hope that you have something that is useful for you. Okay, thank you for your time. Sorry? Yes, Linux Mint, yes. Personally, I didn't like it. It's because of the menus. I prefer this kind of menu. And Linux Mint looks a bit like Windows. I find my way easier here.
Okay.
But Linux Mint is a good system. It's very user friendly. It's like Ubuntu. Yes, it is. It is lighter than Ubuntu, but this is even lighter. I mean, I use XFCE. It's a real